Frozen majestic walls of ice. This is what you might envision when you think of glaciers. But these are also examples of glaciers. You don't see them? Well, that's why today we're heading up to Gradenkirch Glacier in the Austrian Alps to see what happens if we put this onto this. Or to be more precise, what happens if a glacier is covered by a debris layer. Because that's exactly the case for Gradenkirch Glacier. You can't see it because it's hiding under debris. You don't believe me? And how is that even possible? Well, let's head up the mountain to find some glacier ice. The main valley already shows signs of ancient glacial activity, such as glacial lakes. This, of course, does not mean that there is still a glacier present, but when passing by the largest glacial lake, we already find the first sign of ice and snow melt. Because even though it hasn't rained for more than 10 days, we have a significant net outflow out of the lake. The lower part of the debris slope is quite vegetated. There are larger mossy patches in between the debris and the former glacial ponds. Based on the vegetation and altitude, I wouldn't expect ice below the debris on the lower section of the slope anymore. So, no glacier after all? I continue heading up the mountain, passing by seemingly endless amounts of debris. At the upper quarter of the slope, there are more and more patches of icy snow. So, is this finally the glacier? Negative. It's not part of the glacier yet. It's just old snow on top of the debris layer. So snowfall can form an ice layer on top of the debris. But how does the ice get under the debris? Here you see a simplified cross-section of a debris-free glacier with an accumulation zone at higher altitudes and an ablation zone at the terminus. If the glacier's mass is in balance, the mass gain through snowfall in the higher elevated regions is identical to what melts away in the lower parts of the glacier during the year. Over time, the glacier ice deforms and redistributes ice back to its initial state. If rockfall or landslides occur from the surrounding slopes, within the accumulation zone, this debris is buried. As decades pass, this debris is transported within the glacier. Also, the basal sliding of the glacier carves the underlying bedrock. With time, this debris melts out at the glacier's terminus and builds up a thickening debris layer. Debris can also be transported on the surface if debris is displaced directly in the glacier's ablation zone. If glaciers merge together, this can result in these long narrow ridges of debris called medial moraines. For many debris-covered glaciers, especially where the debris cover is only at the terminus, the debris builds up the thickest at lower altitudes and then thins for higher elevation. But the debris thickness and distribution, as well as the debris grain size, can strongly vary between glaciers and regions. For instance, Gradenkirch Glacier is almost completely covered with debris, and we can find small, to huge, to very huge debris sizes with varying thicknesses across the glacier. But does this debris even affect the underlying glacier? Because of the darker color of the debris, it absorbs more solar energy in contrast to clean ice. In this example, we see that the snow around this rock melts away faster due to the rock's higher temperature. But on a glacier scale, we don't only have one rock, but a complete layer of debris with variable debris thicknesses covering the glacier. This thermal camera image shows that the debris surface heats up much faster and stronger than the icy snow patches. Here, darker red colors correspond to warmer temperatures. So does the underlying ice melt away faster in general? For thin or patchy debris layers, we have a similar effect. As for a single rock, the debris is heated up by the sun and therefore accelerates surrounding glacier ice melt. Thicker debris layers, in contrast, act as a natural insulator, protecting the glacier ice from direct sunlight, because the sun has to heat up the debris first before it can melt the ice. This property of debris is nicely illustrated by glacier tables. In a more or less clean ice ablation zone, the ice melts away around large rocks, but the insulation of the rock protects the ice directly below it from melting, resulting in this pillar of ice. After some climbing, I'm up on the mountain right now. Even though there's no glacier down at the lake anymore, you can still see the characteristic flow lines heading down the slope. These lines are of different color are created by a glacier's laminar flow, which transports sediment from different source areas with different colors downhill. This is an important finding because for a body of ice to be classified as a glacier, it requires a flow. But now I finally want to find some ice. As you might have noticed, it's extremely hard to find out under what parts of this debris we can still find ice. One method to find ice is by simply digging pits. Even though this can be quite labor-intensive, but the work has paid off. We were quite lucky, because here we could excavate a bit of the glacier's ice under a thick debris layer, especially of quite huge boulders, and we can see that we have a significant stream flowing downslope, forming these channels in the glacier ice. And you can even hear the stream from above the debris layer. Further downslope, the stream under the debris is heading down a small waterfall several meters into the glacier ice. This allows us to look deeper into the glacier and verify a minimum ice thickness of several meters, so we finally can say for sure we're standing on a glacier, or at least what's left of it. We've seen that the debris depth is crucial with a sub-debris melt, so that's what we're going to try and find out how thick the debris layer is at different locations across the slope. So this means more digging. We managed to find areas with a very shallow debris layer of just 10 to 20 centimeters, but only a few meters apart. We could have continued digging for hours before we would have found ice. This shows the great variability in the debris layer. For precise data, we would need more sophisticated equipment, such as a ground-penetrating radar. But for this glacier, it is safe to say that its thick debris cover reduces the melt, in contrast to a clean ice glacier. From satellite images, we managed to identify a very small zone of debris-free glacier ice. But without new snow mass feeding the glacier, this remaining glacier ice mass will stagnate and slowly vanish. But what does this mean for glaciers on a global scale that are retreating due to climate change? Glacier thinning results in more and more debris melting out of the ice, resulting in thickening debris layers. This is especially the case for tectonically active mountain regions such as Alaska, the European Alps, or the Himalayas. Thickening debris layers in those regions therefore might help to slow down glacier melt. So the next time when you're hiking in the mountains, you might want to take a closer look if there are glaciers hiding. What topic should I cover next? Let me know in the comments below. And if you want to learn more about why climate change does not affect all glaciers equally, click on the next video.